If any of you have actually watched all my videos, you might be starting to think I'm purely here to promote series Satsuki Yukino features in. I'm not, but it definitely didn't do anything to dampen my excitement when I found out she was playing the female lead in Babylon. That said, I was already sold the second I heard the premise. Babylon is a fall 2019 show that slipped under a lot of people's radars and knocked everyone who has seen it out cold, based on the novel by Madon Nozaki and brought to us by new studio Reveroot. Now, I learnt a long time ago that by the season anime watching and my atrocious attention span are a match made in hell and will leave even the best of shows relegated to on-hold oblivion or just straight up dropped. As such, I tried to wait until Babylon was done to watch it, I really did. Spoiler alert, it didn't work. I needn't have worried though, I watched it all in one sitting as soon as I had the time, did the same thing again with a friend in tow about 2 days later, and have been thinking about it ever since. So, what is Babylon? For one thing, it's one of anime's all too rare psychological thrillers. In the show, we follow public prosecutor Zen Seizaki, who operates from the newly formed Shinyuki district of Tokyo. Initially, it seems as though we're going to tag along as Seizaki investigates a pharmaceutical company's false advertising, and then one blood-stained sheet of paper shatters the illusion that this is going to be a regular case. It becomes evident pretty quickly that Seizaki has uncovered only the very tip of the iceberg in a political scandal that will shake the foundations of his world. If you came into this video not knowing anything about Babylon and that sounds in any way up your street, I strongly encourage you to click away now and watch the 8 episodes currently out before you carry on. I'm not one to say spoilers can remotely ruin any good series, but Babylon really deserves an uninitiated first viewing, if only for the sheer mindfuck factor, no pun intended. And why am I doing a video on a character we barely know anything about from a series that's still airing? Great question. I obviously have no self-control. In all seriousness, I really agonised over this, and in the end I decided that I wanted to put my thoughts on Magase out there now before we find out any more, while I, as a viewer, am still in very much the same position as Seizaki, trying to work out what the fuck is going on. I'm willing to share my interpretations as they currently stand because, contrary to what some might say, I think the first two arcs tell us plenty about Magase already in their current state, and hopefully my views are only built upon and not utterly dashed like a sandcastle by the waves in whatever the last arc brings. I want to talk about how Babylon's direction and writing have led me to have this view of Magase's character, and how absolutely they allow her to exemplify her role as a villain. The important thing to acknowledge about Magase is that she is a symbolic character based on the Whore of Babylon from the New Testament's Book of Revelation. Shocking and controversial, the Book of Revelation was an apocalyptic prophecy written to rally Christians and encourage them to hold strong to their faith in a time of hardship, with the promise that their persecutors would reap what they had sown. The book is characterized by strong imagery, and the Whore of Babylon is no exception. Titled Mystery, Babylon the Great, the Mother of Harlots and of the Abominations of the Earth, she is a figure clothed in purple and scarlet who appears riding a beast. The Whore of Babylon immediately takes form as more a force of corruption than a singular individual, described as sitting on many waters and engaging the kings of the earth in sexual immorality. She's largely considered to represent spiritual adultery, with churches often being depicted as women in the Bible in order to further this metaphor. More specifically, she is portrayed as drawing people away from God's teachings. The beast she rides, with its appearance of a leopard, feet of a bear, lion's mouth, and 10 horns, is speculated to represent some mishmash of the political kingdom she has exercised her influence on. It's hard to make sense of Magase as a character if we do not accept her symbolic nature. I know some viewers have lost interest with the furtherment of a seemingly supernatural explanation for her powers, having hoped for a more human and thus more interesting villain. I do sympathise, it was my initial thinking too, and there's no saying we won't eventually find out more about, say, her childhood. The show does equally seem to be self-aware on this point though. What I want to explain is why, as I see it, Magase's ability by no means undermines her legitimacy as a villain, nor that of the messages she evokes. The first arc of Babylon, encapsulating the first 3 episodes and ending with Itsuki's proposition of the suicide law, is titled Itteki no Doku, a drop of poison. This poison is Magase, able to infiltrate and pollute Shinyuki's entire political system. For one thing, Itsuki is likely acting from entirely under her influence, and potentially has been for a very long time. This arc sets the stage, embroiling Sayazaki entirely in Magase's web as he lags constantly 5 steps behind. The second arc, having concluded with the 7th episode before the show went on hiatus, is titled Erabaretashi, The Chosen Death. This arc introduces us to what appears to be Babylon's core theme, the breakdown of social norms, beautifully. With the bombastic introduction of Shinichi's first law, we see Sayazaki and co. flounder to actually find any legal basis from which they can dispute Itsuki's actions. It makes us consider just how much we rely on the law to take down the bad guys. Often we see evildoers in fiction and in real life evading capture with deception and power, but with the promise that their actions, by our collective understanding and that of the laws, are wrong. What happens when that safety net disappears and our concept of what is right is called into question as a result? This uncomfortable prospect is only taken to greater extremes as the arc progresses. The final arc then, even with 4 episodes still to air, seems aptly titled Magaru Sekai, Twisted World. The kanji from Magase's name are in there as well. Rather than simply analysing Magase as a character, I want to talk specifically about each of her key scenes, with a focus on episode 2's spliced interrogations and episode 7's monologue. Not only do these already achieve a great deal in isolation, they comment directly on one another. Before the interrogation ever begins, there's already something worth considering. The show makes sure we know of the presence of a central female antagonist through its advertising, making it fairly easy to surmise said antagonist is likely this mysterious woman we spend so much time with here. What this means is we, unlike Sayazaki, are entirely in on her act of the unassuming victim, even before the facade slowly slips over the course of the episode. This makes the power dynamic clear before anybody has so much as opened their mouth, as we join her in waiting for Sayazaki to realise this as she strings him along. I have plenty to say about Magase as a female villain that I'll come to. For now, one of the first things immediately evident is the expectancy violation Sayazaki is experiencing. Found often in the police interview and trial process when making judgments on female victims of sexual and domestic violence, expectancy violation is the phenomenon by which said victims lose credibility merely by failing to display whichever pattern of behaviour their observer considers appropriate from somebody having had their experiences. Sayazaki already has a preformed idea of how this interaction should go, all the more so for likely having interviewed other women for the same purposes in the past. He's immediately bothered by Magase not conforming to his image of the prostituted woman, with her constant buffers that Anno is a nice man. We know Sayazaki's aim is just and can sympathise. He wants her to cut to the chase, knowing very well this isn't the full picture. But still, in his mind, he's written the script and she's refusing to play the part. He's not come into this interrogation with the intention of finding out her side of the story, but making her conform to his narrative. It's no wonder that he quickly begins to lose his temper. Her actions and words come to seem as though orchestrated to purposefully annoy him. Moreover, to demonstrate that she will not play by his rules. When Sayazaki asks Magase why she thinks Anno is interested in her, there's a deliberate cut to her body. Her face, her identity, obscured, irrelevant. By the time we've gotten to the visualization of the night at the hot springs, Sayazaki is evidently distracted, captivated by the very same thing. A whole day and a half later, Magase shows she's running things on her schedule. When she offers him the bait of her signed testimony, Sayazaki has no choice but to concede to her request to tell her about himself. When this whole sequence begins, Magase comments on Sayazaki's name. Her returning to it here only further implies she's known what she was doing from the very beginning. By now, Sayazaki is worn down, nervous, and defensive. The idea that he was going to get Magase to answer his questions now seems laughable. Magase begins her personal interrogation while already seemingly anticipating his answers, so that she ends up using him to illustrate her very own point. The ultimate conclusion we come to in this scene, from Sayazaki's own mouth, is that people have to attempt to understand each other, no matter how incompatible. If that doesn't already sound familiar, I'll be coming back to it. When Magase finally asks him whether murder is wrong, he uses it as an excuse to lash out at her the way he has evidently wanted to for some time. Finally, she seems to concede. Yes, murder is terrible. Specifically, she uses the word sayaku. The kanji literally mean the worst or most evil. They're in agreement on that much, and her work is done. When Magase leaves entirely of her own accord, we realise she could have done this at any time. Before we get into the second scene I want to look at in this video, let's discuss what they bookend. For the time being, murder fades into the background as suicide now takes centre stage, and by extension, Magase's means of enslaving her victims. The other key aspect of her character to me is the commentary she provides on female sexuality as viewed by society. The first scene that really delves into this is that of Seizaki and Sekiro's trip to visit Magase's uncle, Dr. Sakabe. There's a few things that stand out to me here. Despite the pervasive narrative of rape, as Sekiro points out, however her supposed victims feel, Magase did not touch any of the seven boys she was accused of harming, nor the doctor himself. Abuse is, of course, very much possible without physical contact, sexual harassment being no exception, but the doctor himself concedes. Magase did not do anything besides draw his attention to his own capacity to be attracted to a child and member of his own family. His discomfort ultimately lies not with her, but with himself. He mentions two important concepts, awareness of one's own immorality and the emotional response of guilt. Now, I want to be clear here, much like Magase, the doctor did not do anything wrong. Even more noteworthy are the seemingly innocent boys she disturbed so profusely. This series of incidents, much like the show's suicide dilemma, are complicated to consider. On paper, Magase is innocent, but the harm caused remains. Moreover, unlike other female villains of her ilk who weaponize their sexuality, she does not seem to be motivated by a drive for pleasure, nor remotely affected by the carnal desires she draws out in those around her. There's certainly something otherworldly about the effortless destruction she leaves in her wake. She isn't unlike a siren, able to lead men to their deaths with her voice alone. If we consider Kujin's final conversation with Seizaki, it does not seem to be the content of what she whispers that is significant, but more her mere existence in itself and its ability to make men vividly, maddeningly aware of their own base desires and how controlled they are by them. She acts like a mirror, realizing in the case of the doctor and likely her male classmates, their worst and most private fears. Babylon is visceral, disturbing, and altogether brilliant in how elegantly it delivers its viewing experience. This sequence made me deeply uncomfortable. This is obviously the point. It took me time, however, to put my finger on just what about it was so upsetting. For the utterly pervasive narrative of Magase as the villain, the thing that struck me about this scene as a woman was how strongly it evoked the feeling of being deemed a sexual entity against your own will by the men around you even as a child. My mind is drawn back to Magase's existence as a symbolic character and her very first introduction as simply female. So what Magase does probably does feel like some kind of violation, but it only works if there's something hidden in your own mind she can turn against you. This is my theory of Magase's power. There's a promotional video on the Babylon Anime's Twitter account wherein you basically experience this firsthand ASMR style. Besides fulfilling my personal dream of having Satsuki Yukino whisper directly into my ear, it literally hands us the answer to the question of what Magase actually tells people on a platter. I'm certainly not fluent in Japanese, but from what I can tell, it's more or less what you'd expect. A lot of, is your life really that good? And wouldn't it be so easy to be dead? Again, it's all good and well saying Magase leads people to their deaths, and there's no doubt these people aren't in some kind of hypnosis-esque state, but I'm willing to bet this influence doesn't work on people who aren't already on some level asking themselves these questions. Considering these are the kinds of things I think when I've spent 10 minutes with my face in someone's armpit on a rush hour tube, Magase finding 60-odd people of this mindset throughout Central Shiniki seems pretty realistic to me. Jokes aside, I think this equally sheds some light onto the people Magase has thus far failed to exert her influence on. By my estimation, Seizaki, Sekiro, and Fumio. While we don't know that she's actually tried in any of these cases, they stand out as three characters driven by seemingly unshakable ideals. And then there's Fumio and Sekiro's identical faux suicide notes. Still, these are all just theories. There's one scene in this show that does a spectacular job of actually laying everything we need to know about Magase's character, at least currently, out on the table. In anime's most shocking scene in recent memory, Magase aims to convince Seizaki that they aren't that different. She is proposing to him the most reprehensible concept possible, that someone like her and someone like him could understand each other. There's going to be a lot of callbacks to the interrogation scene here. When she says murder is wrong there, we take it as shorthand to mean she wouldn't do it, at least not so publicly. In actual fact, she fully comprehends the immorality of the act and still chooses it. This is what sets Magase apart. She defies the common perception that villains are simply insane. In fiction, we are so often presented with characters who commit acts of extreme violence out of acute mental instability or else psychopathy. There is an evident disconnect from reality, be it perceptual or emotional. In real life, we justify crime with the same outlandish mindset, and often hear violent acts described in similar terms. When you look at the statistics for domestic and sexual violence in particular, this plainly is not true. It is pure fact that these crimes are being committed constantly without our knowledge by the kinds of people we see every day, at school or work, even friends and family. People who we would call perfectly normal and sane. Even other acts of interpersonal violence, take gang violence, often have far more mundane explanations. Poverty, cuts to the public sector, stress, discontent. Magase is a great villain because, for all the hyperbole of her character, she really embodies this concept, that the people in this world who do terrible things are most often people we could look in the eye and have a regular conversation with without ever knowing, that they are comfortable in their actions or at least fully aware of what they entail, that there aren't so many differences between us after all. When Magase now blatantly calls back to the interrogation with the question of whether people who prefer cats and people who prefer dogs could be compatible, we see just how far ahead her plan had stretched from day one, and that if Seizaki has ever felt even remotely in control, it is only out of her having given him the illusion of being so. This equally demonstrates that she does understand him on some level, and is able to predict not only his words but even his actions. This is presumably mortifying for Seizaki, who has consistently underestimated Magase by writing her off as being purely evil, all the while failing to see through to her thoughts whatsoever the same way she has him. Magase provides her own answers to her questions now. They don't have to compromise their views of the topics, be they choice of pet or the morality of murder. They must only seek to understand why one another hold those views. Babylon is addressing us here as much as Seizaki. Have we ever tried to understand evil? Finally, Magase proposes that we can understand evil. We treat the act of understanding as a Pandora's box, as though to even try would be to bring us closer to villainy ourselves, or would compromise our goodness. In the case of suicide, the fear is that allowing people to seriously consider it will likewise encourage it. This is why we so often explain away things that scare us as being insane. Ultimately, we do not want to consider that we too could be capable of them. Magase points out that when we organize ourselves into these binaries, we divide ourselves. There's a meaning to evil, she says, and there is for those who do it, but we continually ignore this. Seizaki is not simply experiencing the trauma of what he is witnessing here, but that of trying to comprehend Magase's propositions. She represents the breakdown of our values and norms, a truly frightening, larger-than-life concept. Even so, she remains startlingly human. To quote another favourite series, Umineko, "People are riddles. They live life wanting someone to solve the riddle that they are. The most difficult riddle in the world." Even if Magase is an evil creature of supernatural origin or a symbolic character, the dilemma remains the same. She has never been understood. She is immediately drawn to Seizaki as someone wholly dedicated to one worldview and set of ideals, much like herself. In this way, much like Magase represents the concept of evil, Seizaki is the emblem of respectable society. And Magase does speak of this now, specifically of Seizaki being raised in a good society surrounded by good things, in contrast to the bad things she does. Her choice of words here stands out. Shakai for society, not Sekai for world. This casts her worldview in something more concrete and objective. Magase constantly uses a tone of condescension when talking to Seizaki, as though she knows more about their shared world than him. Even in her parroting of the phrases, good things, bad things, evil, it's as though she's ridiculing his simplistic, emotional language. To speak as though she understands this side of society, that which makes up his career, better than him is the ultimate challenge to his identity as a prosecutor. She tells him now that he's probably never thought of something bad. In any other context, this would be a slightly off-color compliment. Instead, Magase sounds almost pitying, or perhaps envious, and Seizaki's simplistic view of justice as being about punishing bad people makes it seem this is true. Many supposedly bad people are responding to the bad things they've had done to them, perhaps responding to what is, in their view, a fundamentally bad world. From the dilemma of Dr. Sakabe and the seven students, to the televised suicide debate and Itsuki's actions, to Seizaki's response to kidnap him and his many willing co-conspirators, to paint the world as being possible to separate into good and bad people is beginning to seem woefully inadequate. The continual positing of the question, what does justice mean to you, especially by Fumio as Seizaki's first assistant and Sekiro as his second, is a simple yet effective way to underline this realization Seizaki is undergoing, and who has caused this introspection. Still, Magase tells him directly now, you have no idea what evil is. Finally, we reach the crux of the matter. Why is it a bad thing to kill someone? Why is it a good thing to let people live? We've already spent the arc considering the second question. Magase shows us now that they are two sides of the same coin. Moreover, Seizaki has spent all this time calling her a murderer without evidence of her actually laying a finger on anybody. She finally shows him. This is what evil looks like. The scene is at its most ruthless when Magase begins to hammer him with the same questions again and again, knowing full well he cannot answer and has no power to stop her. I'm sure you'll understand, comes now as a threat as we cut back and forth between the two of them and Seizaki's wife and son. There's nothing you wouldn't be able to understand. Seizaki is nothing more than a proxy at this point, as Magase addresses us directly through the camera. The final line of the scene is likewise the best, because we're both human. Wherever Babylon goes from here, I'd be hard-pressed to name another scene from anime I love more. It goes without saying, the direction, voice acting, and music here are all phenomenal, alongside what is a masterclass in dialogue writing. It took time for me to go back and realize how little we actually see of what's happening to Sekiro, thanks to some discreet and clever shot composition. Babylon treads a very fine line with the shock value of its content, but it pulls it off. The emotions of the characters are all we need in this scene to feel how utterly horrific it is. To go on a brief tangent, I've seen some people jumping to call Magase a yandere on the heels of episode 7. When people talk about yandere, they're talking about female characters obsessed with the object of their affections to the point of mental instability. These characters are willing to commit any act of violence to bring them closer to said individual, be it eliminating the competition or simply something that will draw their attention. The problem with calling Magase this is implying she's somehow at the whims of her feelings for Seizaki, whatever they may be, or is acting the way she does because of him. While it's true that she's doing her level best to completely break him, if we're to trust her words, we know that she does have wider goals and motivations. She has been the fascinating train wreck of a person she is since long before ever meeting him. Most of all, I simply think it does her a disservice to imply she is deranged and lovesick, as opposed to acting with clear purpose that extends far beyond one man. In conclusion, Babylon has done nothing if not made me think, and there are still 4 episodes to go. Beyond the specific debates put forth, it asks, should we uphold a surely flawed concept of justice and rule with an iron fist, or is there merit in seeking to understand? The Book of Revelation warns not to compromise, stating Christians cannot truly worship God whilst embracing false doctrines or those unlike themselves. Do not become unevenly yoked with unbelievers. For what fellowship do righteousness and lawlessness have? Or what sharing does light have with darkness? Further, what harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Or what does a believer share in common with an unbeliever? And what agreement does God's temple have with idols? Corinthians 6:14. In the most extreme way conceivable, Magaser demonstrates a genuinely compelling case. Above all, she evokes the odiousness of the concept that anyone human has a right to decide who should live and who should die. In the story of the Tower of Babel, humans come together to try and build a tower that reaches heaven. In response to this, God casts them all over the world and gives them many languages, such that they cannot work together to the same end ever again. This story's meaning remains up for debate. One message, however, is clear. Humans must not try to become like God. Lastly, there is something interesting about Seizaki's name. As we know, it shares its character with Seigi. Together, these kanji mean the right justice. So often, Magase is called Sayaku, the worst evil. Both words imply a plurality, and as the show points out, our very idea of what is right or wrong has changed drastically over time. Across the world, or even in our own countries and communities, we still differ. Babylon's arguments about suicide and murder come from the basic concept that, if nothing else, humans must treat life as sacred. This is treated as a value all understand and should adhere to. As for the suicide law, at least in Babylon, as of the most recent episode, there is, as predicted, a drop in the number of people opting for it post-legalization. The idea that those who wish to die for whatever reason might be given the right to do so comfortably seems just. And yet, as Ryuichiro points out during the debate, who wants to live in a world where people won't tell those in pain to keep fighting? Morally, it is everyone's right to take their life, but we feel an equal duty as fellow humans to act as a buffer for fear of feeling otherwise complicit. Our hope is that our direct opposition will force the individual to reconsider. We all understand this concept, it's why helplines exist. We can see the belief that opposition is necessary to come to the best decision embedded deep in our society, from televised debates to the adversarial system. Magase then embodies this resistance, not to any one argument, but to the stagnant and unchanging pillars of belief upholding modern society. In this way, Babylon digs right to the core of our values, norms, and laws, and shows how inconsistent, nonsensical, and altogether fragile they really are. What did happen to lead Magase down the path she has taken, and will there come a time when Seizaki makes similar decisions? Indeed, when he truly does understand her. What would it take for us to do the same? Above all, Babylon is great because it makes us ask these taboo, complicated questions. It reminds us just how many people do every single day. It shows how frightening it can be when the powers that guide us are corrupted with ideals that are not our own. It shows how frightened we are of losing ourselves. After all, who are we if not the values we live by? And of course, it asks us to keep thinking. Magase is not an exceptional villain because she represents any one moral or even a lack thereof, but instead their ultimate impermanence. Babylon creeps into our mind and probes our sense of security. It is insidious, chilling, and utterly masterful in its demonstration of just how shaky the foundations our societies and identities are built on really are. So much so, even one breath could send them all toppling down.